Hello, in this video, we're going to talk about searching through a list or some sort of data type that has multiple data types inside of it or data inside of it. So generally, whenever we talk about searching, we're talking about two different types of searches that we're going to cover here. One is called a linear search and the other one is called a binary search. Now, the difference between a linear search and a binary search is its complexity. How much time does it take to actually look at that? Generally, what we do is we look at the average case. How on average long is it going to take to search for an item inside of a list? So for example, on here, here's the reason we do this. As you can see, if we look for the element 5, it's going to take no time at all. We look at the very first element and we just keep moving on and we see that 5 is in there. But we'll see that the average case, on average, say we wanted to look for 19. Well, in 19, we'd have to skip the 5, skip the 1, skip the 2, skip the 39, and find the 19 way down the list. Now think of this as if you had a large data set of billions of records, millions to billions of records. And as you can see, the complexity actually will start making a difference. With these small little test cases that I have here, it probably doesn't make that much of a difference, but you'll see that whenever you start looking and increasing the data set size, that's when we actually care about how much data we're actually sharing in there. So let's take a look at this. So I've created a list called Hay. It's short for Haystack. Generally, what you'll see is inside of this, we have a haystack. And we're looking for a needle inside that haystack. It's just a little fun picking at this sort of stuff. So what they're going to do, or what we're going to do, is do two different types of searches, a linear search followed by a binary search. So a linear search is what you've seen before. Now, in a list, you actually can find elements inside of a list. However, to manually do that, and the reason we're manually doing this is to show you the complexities that actually have to go on to find things. Just because we have a sort, a list.sort or something like that, it just seems like it just happens and things just happen. But you'll see that based on complexity, the more data sets or the more data we start putting in a set, the longer it's going to take to actually do it because we require more computational processing power. So let's take a look at your screen here. And you can see I have the haystack built. It's an unsorted list, but we're just going to search through it. So we're going to create a search function, and the search function needs to take two parameters. The first parameter is the haystack. That's what list do we actually want to search from? And then the needle, what data type are we actually looking for? So you can see this is a list of integers. So the haystack itself must be a list of integers, and the needle itself must be an integer. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at 5. Okay, does that equal the needle? Nope, we move on to the 1. Does that equal the needle? Nope, we keep moving on until we find it. If we don't find it, we're going to return -1, because -1 is not a possible index in a list. Remember, the possible indices that we have with a list is 0, that's the first one, all the way to length -1. So if we had a list of 10, we'd have 0 through 9. So let's take a look at how we're going to do this. So we can use just a normal iteration loop. So we're going to say for I in range, length of haystack, okay? So I is going to start with 0, go to 1, go to 2, go to 3, go to 4, all the way through all the indices inside of our haystack. So remember, the search, the function, its job is to return me the index where it found the needle. That's why we have to use range of length haystack instead of just using for I in hay. Because if we did for I in hay, we would be getting the values back. That's not what we want. But we do want the value because we're going to compare that to the needle. However, it doesn't, we'd have to sort of reverse engineer that so we can give you the index where I found that. So this way here, we have the index, which is I in this case. So if we do find the needle, we just return I. If we don't find the needle, that means we're done with the for loop. We're going to return -1. Sorry, semicolons are for C++. I'm just so used to that. So in this case, what we're going to do is we're just going to check the element that we're currently looking at. If it's not it, we just move on to the next element. If we do find the needle, then there's no reason to keep looping. So we're just going to return the index, which in this case is I. Okay, and that's essentially all a linear search is. In a linear search, as you can see through this, for I in range length haystack, essentially what that's going to do is it's going to loop through every single element inside of our haystack. If the needle is equal to what we're currently looking at, that means we found it. So let's take a look at how this is going to work. So we're going to a search. We'll search in the haystack for the value 7. So you can see 7 is sitting right over here. So we'll test it out with 7 first. And then what we'll do is we'll print search haystack 100. As you can see, 100 doesn't exist in there. And so based on the algorithm that we designed, it will return -1 if we can't find the needle inside this haystack. So let's go and run this and see what happens. Notice we get the value 6 and we get the value -1. So 6 is telling us the index 6. So remember, 5 is the index 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So index 6 is the value 7. It could be whatever value you want. So now we know we searched through the list using a linear search, and we looked for the value 7. And it told us that the value 7 is at index 6. Then we did on line 10 here, we did a print search hey of 100. As you can see, 100 doesn't exist in the haystack, and so it gave us the value negative 1. So let's take a look at a different type of search called a binary search. Now, the reason we call this a binary search is because we're splitting the list into two pieces every single time. So there is one drawback with a binary search. This haystack will not work for a binary search. A binary search requires that we have a sorted list, and here's why. So let's take a look at what happens if we have a sorted list. So let's say we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, so whenever we're looking for this, let's say we're looking for the value 4. Okay, so we're looking for the value 4. So as you can see, what we're going to do is we have to have a starting point. And the starting point is always going to be in the middle, because that is the most efficient way to find out where we are. Because if we compare the middle, which in this case is 2, if we compare the middle with the needle that we're looking for, which is 4, then we could see that it's greater than 2. 4 is greater than 2. Well, because this is a sorted list, that eliminates all possibilities to the left. Anything in index less than 2 means that it can't possibly be 4 because it's sorted in ascending order in this case. So we're going to call this part of the list left. We're going to call this part of the list right. So what we do is we look at the midpoint, and then we compare our needle. Remember, our needle is equal to 4. That's what we're looking for inside this list. So this is what we're going to call our midpoint, MP. So we look inside of the list at the midpoint, and it gives us the value 2. Because this is a sorted list, we know that we don't need to look at anything less than MP. So what we're going to do is we're going to set the left equal to MP plus 1. So what that's done is now the list has been shrunk. Now the list, the actual list itself, we're not modifying the list, we're searching through it, but the elements that we're actually searching through has shrunk. Why? Because we know if the value 4, the needle that we're looking for, is greater than 2, that means it must belong in the upper elements of the list. Otherwise, it must belong in the lower elements, okay? So then we just repeat the algorithm until we find it or until there's no more elements to find. So what we're going to do is we're going to take the midpoint of this list, this new list, 3, 4, and 5. So our midpoint is in the middle, which is 4. And notice that our needle is equal to 4, and so we just found our needle. Now, if we were to do this using a linear search, so notice that just took 2 iterations. If we were to do this in a linear search, we'd have to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 iterations to do that. So you can see we've cut down the complexity. Now, basically, if we can get our list sorted, or if we're putting elements into a data set into a list that's already sorted, we can search through it by using what's called a binary search. Now, the binary search is going to take, on average, log of the number of elements in there. So we have 5, we have 6 elements in here. So it's going to take log 6, log base 2 of 6. So the reason we do log base 2 is because it's a binary search. We're always splitting the list into twos. So we're always cutting it in half. That's why it's log base 2. So let's take a look at how we can actually implement this. So number one, we're not going to do sorting in this lecture. I'll do that in another video. But in this one, we're just talking about searching. So I'm going to use hey.sort to use Python's built-in sort, and it will go ahead and sort that. Just to show you that it modifies it in place, you can see that whenever we sorted it, now we have 111, 222, 3, 4, 4, 5, 5, 7, 19, and 39. So it is a sorted list now. So now that I have hey as a sorted list, we're going to run a binary search. Okay, so in this case, we still have a haystack and we still have a needle. Okay, so once again, what we're trying to do is we have to establish the bounds that we're actually going to search through. Now that we don't know what the midpoint is, we don't know anything about this, we're going to set the left equal to 0 because that's the first index that's inside of a list. We're going to set the right to the last element, which is the length of the haystack, minus 1. So remember, if we have an element that has 10, or if we have a list with 10 elements inside of it, we have 0 through 9, which is length minus 1. So length will give us 10, minus 1 is the last index that we can use. So now you can see we have left and right. So now we're considering the whole list. So what we're going to do is we're going to say while left is less than or equal to right. So what does that mean? So what we're doing is notice that we keep splitting our list in two. If the left and the right ever cross, because of the math that we do, that means we couldn't find the element. And what that's going to mean is we're going to return negative one, that we could not find it, okay? So while left is less than right. So in this case, let's take a look at the list that we have here. In this case, zero is going to be less than the length minus one of this entire list. You can see it contains more than one item inside there. Now, if there's only one item inside of our list, left would equal zero, right would equal to zero. So while left is less than or equal to right, that's why we have to have that or equals to inside there. Because if there's only one element in there, we just have to compare that element with the needle. If it is the needle, we found it. Otherwise, if it's not the needle, then we have to return negative one. So let's take a look at this now that we have left is less than or equal to right. So once again, we're going to calculate the midpoint, which is the left plus the right divided by two. So remember, this is just the midpoint formula. You just take the left, add it to the right, and you divide it by two. Now, the reason I have to use the double forward slash is because we want integer division. We're going to use MP, the midpoint, as an index into the list. And Python requires that to be an integer, it can't be a float. I wouldn't even know what a float would do. So like 2.5, what index would that be? A little bit of two and a little bit of five, who knows? So now that we have our midpoint established, now we have to do several comparisons. Okay, is it equal to the needle? If it is, we found it and we can just run it. So if needle is equal to the haystack at that midpoint, that means we found it. Okay, so we just return the midpoint, which is the value that we found. Otherwise, now we have to see, do we need to search the lower half of the list or do we need to search the upper half of the list? Because remember, this is a sorted array. So if the needle is bigger than the midpoint, that means we have to search the upper half of the list. That means right is still good, but now we need to move left so that we're only considering that right half of the list. Otherwise, we only need to consider the lower half of the list. So okay. So notice I'm not using greater than or equal to. The if statement on line 8 already checked for equality. If they're not equal, that means the else if statement in this case will run. So we don't need to check for equality ever again because we already did it on line 8. So now we're saying if the needle is greater than the haystack, what that means is we only consider the upper half list. We already know that the midpoint that we're currently at is not the target, because otherwise we would have already returned it. So in this case, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna set the left equal to the midpoint plus one. So what I do is we know it's not the midpoint. So we check the very next element adjacent to it on the right-hand side. So the left moves, but the right doesn't. Otherwise, so it's not equal, it's not greater than, therefore the else statement says it must be less than. If it's less than, that means we have to search the lower half of the list. Now, this is all assuming that we have an ascendingly sorted list. So in this case, we need to move right back down to midpoint minus one, okay? So that's how we're going to do a binary search. Now, inside this binary search, once again, we have to make sure that our haystack is sorted. So let's go down here. Okay, so there's 100, that's not going to exist. So we'll see what happens if we get negative one. In this case, let's search for 19. And in this case, let's search for, all right. So I ran this and as you can see, we have negative one for 100. We have 12 for 19 and 13 for 39. So we can't take a look at this list because it's unsorted. So let's take a look at our sorted list and see if we got the right answers. So number one, 19 tells us it's at index 12. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. So 19 is indeed at index 12. And 13 obviously is the very next one, which is 39. So our binary search works in this occasion. So just to recap what we've done, a linear search is what's called O of N. That means the average case, the worst case, or there's an average, worst, and best case. So the worst case is we have to search through the entire list, and what we're looking for is at the end of the list. That means we have to iterate N times, whereas N is the length of the list. So in this case, you can see index 13. So there are 14 total elements in here. We have to iterate I 14 different times before we can find 39. With the binary search, it's log base 2 of n. So in this case, you can see our midpoint is somewhere over here. So that's one iteration. Then our midpoint, so we only consider the upper half. Midpoint is somewhere over here, that's two iterations. Our midpoint is somewhere over here, that's three iterations. And then it's going to consider the right. So around four iterations. So remember, we had a length of 14, four iterations comes out of there. So it only takes four iterations and still, instead of the worst case, which is 14 iterations to get to 39. So that's why binary search is being used. Linear search works for any kind of list, whereas a binary search requires that the list be sorted in some order. Now, if it's in descending order, obviously these would change. If the needle is less than the haystack, then the right would change instead of the left. But if it's in ascending order, this algorithm holds true. So there you have it. You have linear search as well as binary search. And once again, the reason I'm showing you this is just to show you what happens behind the scenes inside of Python. Python makes your life easier, makes our lives easier too as a programmer, but it's kind of helpful to understand what's actually happening behind the scenes. When we get to NumPy and these data science-y libraries, we want to make sure that it's doing the most efficient way possible. So if there's something odd about your data, you know it's going to be in sorted order, something like that, you can run a binary search on it. Because NumPy, Python, these have to be generic about the list that you're going to give it. So it doesn't know if it's a sorted list. It would actually have to figure that out, which would take time. So if you know it's going to be a sorted list and you just want to search through it over and over again, you can run a binary search on it, develop your own algorithm instead of having to use the generic tools to do that for you. So there you have it. That's linear search and binary search. Thanks for watching.